First, we're going to begin with an address by Inderjeet Parmar, and then Kees will be responding.
Okay. Thank you very much for this invitation. Thanks to Evgeny and to Francesca and Tom for giving me this opportunity to share some of my work with you. And it's very nice also that this panel is being facilitated by Anthony Arnaud, whose father, it turns out, I know was an inspiration to some of the work I did on American foundations. It was Robert Arnaud's book in 1980, the title of which now I can't remember because of my own age, which was very
interesting. Cultural imperialism.
That's the one, yeah. Yes, that's right.
Say it again.
Foundations and Cultural Imperialism.
I don't think that was exactly that,
right.
But it was very similar.
On that topic, yeah.
But it was very a great book. What I want to do today is kind of reconcile three elements. One of which I've worked on for many years, which is the role of elite knowledge networks in American global and domestic power. How networks have developed, how they operate, how they establish authority, how they manage crises and challenges. Then I want to try to connect that with what I've been doing for the last 12 months in my spare time, which is covering the American elections, mainly because of its anti-elitist, anti-establishment tone and character. And now with the Trump presidency looming, what are the implications at home and abroad of that? And thirdly, give a respectful nod to the technology agenda. After all, the title of this meeting and the group and organization has technology in it. I must say I'm very non-technological in most ways. I've never owned a mobile phone, which I inherited from one of my sons. And one of them is here on the table with me. But once I began to see through some sort of technological lens, I began to notice that actually, some of this technological stuff has been going on all the time in some of the things I've been studying, but I just never paid it much attention. And I'm not sure whether it's to do with the fact that I don't think I'm a technological determinist. I know I'm not. But I do think that technology has played a big part in the current, in the recent American election in particular, and I'm sure it's going to continue to play important roles elsewhere, and even within the foundations, some of which I've been studying. The more recent foundations like Gates and Zuckerberg, their origins lie in those technological revolutions themselves and the corporations which express that. So that's what the sort of three elements which I wanted to try to reconcile, and I don't know if this is going to work out completely. And I guess my aim here is to try to show that the crisis that has catapulted Donald Trump to the White House is rooted in deeper long-term shifts in power at home and abroad, and that elite networks, which have played key roles in undergirding and protecting that established order, and how despite loss of expert authority, these networks appear to be recovering their ground and restabilizing the system. The point I'd like to, I guess, want to make is that although the crisis of authority, the crisis of authority is not over, but it is being papered over. But that crisis of authority is kind of out in the open. And I think that is where it opens up space for people who are critical and who want to make some kind of a change, can develop their ideas and also connect with what are already ongoing significant political movements and resistances and struggles, and hopefully join up those who think about the world with those who are already acting in it, because they have no other alternatives but to resist either the drive to war or the drive for austerity policies, which are driving them to the levels of poverty or homelessness and so on. So I'm very, very glad to be here and in a group, among a group of people who come from such a wide variety of sources who are acting in the world as well as thinking about it in various ways. I guess the big story is that the post-1945 US-led world order is in deep crisis at home and abroad. and that these changes which are coming as a result of this crisis at home and abroad are racial, class, they're strategic, they're political, ideological, and technological. And all of these are combined in various ways to undermine or to transform that order. And that Donald Trump is a key result, as was Bernie Sanders, and also as was the defeat of Hillary Clinton. That the rise of populism across Europe, the vote to Brexit in Britain, are further indicators, each in their national setting, of a broader systemic issue and problem with that post-1945 order. It also expresses the other side of that order, which is the demand for mass change, because the decline in the credibility of that order itself, which is what opens up the space for new movements and coalitions to dedicate it to progressive social and economic and political change, to try to oppose what I think now are real dangers, severe dangers of hyper-nationalism and possibly of war. What I argue in my other work is that elite power knowledge networks, and I looked at think tanks and university institutes and American so-called philanthropic foundations, which are really corporate foundations, and the way in which they built networks over time, and are at the heart of American hegemony and the system of power, that they undergird this order, that they have been undermined in severe ways, because they are so close to power that they do not speak truth to power, they actually speak the voice of power to the people. And as the people's positions and locations and their life chances diminish, and their anxieties increase, even if they have jobs, and they have reasonably good jobs, but they're transformed in character, those anxieties are beginning to delegitimize that very system, that expertise, and the political order which they've undergirded over such a long period of time. Although Trump and Sanders and so on represented, in a way, a kind of revolution, I don't think that revolution against that old elite order has been successful. At home, some of my students and I were looking at a project on looking at Donald Trump's appointments, that he's signaling in one direction with his voice and at his rallies, but he's turning in a completely different direction when he makes his appointments or when he makes any kind of policy pronouncements. But when he started off against Wall Street, he is now the darling of Wall Street. And you look at his appointments, they are very heavily corporate, pro-Wall Street, in the hedge funds or Goldman Sachs and so on, the very people that he was criticizing Hillary Clinton to be embedded within already. And when you look at his appointments and his policy pronouncements, which he, when he first started, he was against for higher taxes for the rich and for corporations. He was for greater levels of welfare for white workers and so on. And he has reversed that completely in the kind of character of his appointment that he's made and the policy pronouncements that he's made as well. When he talked about the undermining of the world order and the so-called isolationism of which he was accused, that he was going to challenge NATO and the Korean Treaty and the Japan Treaty, and he was going to ask a question about why America's in the Middle East and supporting Saudi Arabia or whatever, it looks like from the kind of appointments that he makes to the Secretary of Defense or to the National Security Advisor and other appointments as well, that he's rowing back in a very, very strong way from those themselves. So that what it looks like is old elite networks, which looked like they were completely out, with the Sanders base arguing against militarism and war and so on, and against Wall Street, and Trump tapping into those kind of tendencies in a different way, that actually that old elite order seems to be reasserting itself very, very strongly. And I'm going to talk about some of that a little bit later on. But still, that opening which has been created, which is really what made me follow the American election, which is the most interesting election to my mind since my father used to make me observe world politics, because he used to work the night shift and get up too late to listen to the news. He used to make me from the age of 9 take notes and then read out to him whatever a 9-year-old could understand. Which I have to say, the few times that I missed the news bulletin, I used to go and buy the local evening newspaper and tell him what happened in Gillingham, Kent, which I didn't know the difference between local and global politics at that time. But it does open up a large number of opportunities for change. So what I would suggest is that there's a whole series of crises which have occurred to that established order from 1945 onwards. And in particular, these crises have kind of deepened each time, even though there's been a recovery in the relatively short term but even the sources of recovery and the strategies for recovery have only really sown the seeds of a future discontent, because in the end they've largely been system strengthening rather than system challenging. The biggest threat to that system, I would argue, came in the 1970s, or late 60s into the 1970s, with the defeat of the United States in Vietnam, with the OPEC crisis and the declaration by the oil producing countries that they were not going to accept lower prices and so on, with a new international economic order of the G77 or whatever, where the post-colonial states are arguing for a redistribution of wealth, power, in international institutions and so on, that this set of challenges, which combined with the fact that from 1945 to by the mid-70s, the West itself had changed, that the West itself was a looser sort of grouping than it used to be, and that West Germany was no longer on its knees as it was after the war, that Japan was no longer, that is, the defeated powers, had risen economically, that Europe had renewed itself. You combine all of these problems and issues, what you get is a big challenge to that order. But the solution to that order lay within the very sort of, you know, in some ways admirably far-sighted leaders of those very elite knowledge networks. People like Zbigniew Brzezinski, David Rockefeller, and others, who saw not only the loosening of the West and the possibilities of a challenge to the United States authority from within the West, but also saw the challenge to Western authority generally from the Third World, but also diagnosed what would be a strategy to deal with that problem. And it was precisely the kind of thing that Leslie, my old teacher, by the way, who was my personal tutor from October 1980, talked about. That is, when these people talk about the solution to a deep-seated problem, they look to the very system which is the source of the problem as the kind of solution. So they look for growth. And they look back at their own history of how they dealt with the rise of the working class movement in the United States, and how they were able to give quite a lot to some of the workers without actually losing anything from themselves. And that was by co-opting certain elements of the labor leadership, by giving some workers quite a lot of a stake in the system by through economic or other means, and political means, without actually changing the system of power itself. And their diagnosis was, well, since we did that with our own workers in the 1880s and 1890s into the 1910s, we can do this with these third world leaders. Most of them are not interested in real equality anyway. They're not particularly democratic. They don't want egalitarian society as much as we don't want them. What they want is a greater say and a stake for themselves in the system. And guess what? There are a number of these powers which look a little bit like the middle class. They look like middle class powers. People, countries, societies, economies ready to actually take their place within the order, but at a more enhanced level. The Trilateral Commission, their demand, or rather their response for a renovated international economic order, as opposed to a new international economic order, and some of the neoliberals, who were even harder lined than them, argued that what you need to do is to bring some of these people into the system. And it's quite interesting that the countries that they identified at that particular time, in the mid-1970s, as the middle-class powers, actually are the BRIC countries which Goldman Sachs invented in about 2000. Brazil, India, even China, this is interesting. China in the early to mid-1970s, not even before the death of Mao. Indonesia, Mexico, Turkey, and other countries identified as middle-class countries, ready for taking a fuller place within the international order. And that is to say, what they did effectively was they broadened the basis of oligarchy at the global level, but they didn't challenge the fundamentals of oligarchy itself, which is entirely the way in which Anthony Eden described the evolution of the British system when somebody in 1932 said in Parliament that the system was undemocratic. And he said, we have never been democratic. All we've ever done in our evolution and reform is broaden the basis of oligarchy. And that's exactly what these people did at that particular time. So my argument is that it is the after effects or the necessary effects of that at home that there are these middle class powers, that the quid pro quo for recognizing somebody as middle class at the global level is that you have to industrialize, you have to invest a large amount of capital, either through debt or through other foreign investment. But the quid pro quo of that is also the deindustrialization of the West itself. And part of the reason why Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders and others have been able to get such traction is the fact that the impact on the Western working class and the kind of in the Anglo-Saxon countries in particular was very, very severe. And that is those Rust Belt voters, those people who worked in steel or shipbuilding or coal, that is the old smokestack industries, were the most deeply affected by the transfer of work and of capital to the middle class countries. That is, Robert Reich wrote a book called The Work of Nations back in the 1990s, just before or after he was Secretary of Labour under Bill Clinton or whatever. He talks about the redistribution of work and of industry and so on. That has left behind a lot of people. So when you look at that movement and the rise of debt to fuel consumerism, then that consumerism creates even further debt, and which then creates the basis of a financialized system. That financialized system also bleeds into politics and party politics, when both political parties in the United States, Republican and Democratic, Democratic in particular, recognize the necessity of large-scale corporate donations, where they became effectively bedfellows with big business in a more significant way than they were even before, that you get the outcome in 2016. And that this is kind of what to me it sounds like a kind of historic election campaign where Wall Street and the party system were both deeply undermined by two significant candidates, one who became the nominee for the Republican Party, the other who almost became the nominee for the Democratic Party, Sanders. And so what I suggest is that these elite networks, which created a solution, which created the broadened the basis of oligarchy, also created the basis upon which this issue that we've seen in 2016 has been created. Now, what I would suggest is that this election campaign and the Donald Trump presidency, presented as revolutions in American politics, in some respects do represent a kind of a revolutionary shift. I don't think there has been an election campaign. I've been kind of studying elections and to some extent American power overall for a long time. And I don't think there has been such two candidates, Sanders, I mean, as a socialist in the United States. There was Eugene Debs in 1912. And 1920, 900,000 votes, a million votes for the Socialist Party of America. No candidates in the United States political history has stood on a socialist ticket overtly and actually got 13 million votes without counting the caucus states and almost defeated Hillary Clinton. And were it not for the Democratic National Committee's machinations, which Julian Assange and WikiLeaks actually brought to the surface, that he could have been a candidate. In fact, to my mind, he was probably the solution to Hillary Clinton's problem, staring at her in the face, which she sought to see and saw as a block to her ambition, while she identified Donald Trump, also according to WikiLeaks, capable of WikiLeaks, as her ideal opponent. But so what you've got is these kind of elite networks, which are incredibly interesting phenomena. That these corporate philanthropies, that their biggest achievement in my mind is the construction of this power technology, the elite network. And this elite network is, it's mainly a kind of knowledge network, but not in the sense of just airy-fairy, ivory tower thinking, but thinking for use, thinking for politics, thinking for practicality and practical outcomes. They are a marrying of the intellectual who thinks in terms of basic research with those people who are kind of policy entrepreneurs, who try to think about how to use an idea which seems to have no relationship with reality and try to make it into a policy technology which can then be used by a politician as a kind of a solution to a problem that is a governing concept of some form. And that these networks, if you like, involve think tanks and universities and foundations and elements of the brains within the state or thinking institutions within the state. And they're also state-building institutions as well in the American case, because the United States has developed this peculiar history of having a democracy partial from the earliest development of the US without a state whereas the European countries have been the kind of opposite, stronger states but developing democracy broadly going on. But these elite networks, I think, are resilient. They're very, very significant, very powerful at home, and they have been very powerful globally as well. And so in the in my 2012 book, Foundations of the American Century, which is about Ford, Rockefeller, and Carnegie, I look at the way in which they've operated at home from the 1910s onwards to build a kind of a domestic hegemony of liberal internationalism, and a whole array of institutions and networks at home linked with the state, and then how they, after 1945, through area studies programs, international relations as a discipline, a sort of positivistic social science and strategic studies and so on, and then linked all of those with strategic regions and states around the world. Western Africa, Southeast Asia, and in Latin America. So we've got Chile, Nigeria, and Indonesia. And so the Chicago boys and their origins, their construction, by a combination of these foundations and USA, for example, to completely reverse a particular kind of hegemony of ideas about dependista thinking in the most powerful city in Latin America, Santiago, which is a sort of Geneva of Latin America, and to capture the mind of Santiago through the construction of the Chicago boys, and use that as a hub from which to radiate outwards a kind of neoliberal agenda as well. And so these networks are incredibly powerful, and they're very, very, they've got a lesson to teach us as well. They work with whoever will listen to them. They'll work with anybody who gives them a slight opening. And they don't care what kind of regime they operate in. They will listen, and they've learned that at home, because the United States is a really interesting society where you can have people like McCarthy who will call these foundations communist and have them up in Congress and the Senate and call them Marxists and communists and so on, where they then stand up and say, no, 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 we've never knowingly backed the Marxists. And then you can have something like the Walsh Commission in 1915 and 1916, which will say, these foundations are concentrations of corporate wealth, which are exactly what the United States was formed to fight against. They're concentrations of power, which the United States wants to break, because that's what we created this project for, was to give people freedom and so on. So you can have this kind of wide variety. What the foundations did was they learned how to navigate their positions. They never gave up their positions, but their tactics changed over time. So in the sort of fevered period just after World War I, when it looked like a League of Nations was going to be formed and the America was in the forefront of it, they were right behind intellectually, politically, and in every other way behind the League of Nations. But when the Congress and the Senate went against the League of Nations, they didn't give up. They just went to every single element of the state which would listen to them. That is the Treasury and the kind of Dawes plan and the Young plan to furnish loans to Europe, or whichever agency would listen to them, they collaborated with them to further their liberal internationalist agenda, such that they would incubate a kind of counter-hegemony. They didn't call it that, but that's effectively what they were doing. They were doing a kind of Gramscian counter-hegemony in the very heart of a state whose politics had rejected their program. Yet they carried on burrowing away for 20 years, waiting for their moment. And it's interesting that in the May of 1940, a very interesting paper from the Council on Foreign Relations was to the heart of this kind of program. Well, they said, Americans are just too complacent about the European war. They're enjoying long holidays, they're getting good pay, we've got these military contracts, they're just having a laugh. What we need is a catastrophic military attack on the United States to puncture our sense of complacency. This is May 1940. You just would not believe the euphoria on December the 8th, 1941. That these people, I mean, it wasn't just Churchill who was kind of orgasmic about Pearl Harbor, because he saw that as bringing America into the war on the side of Britain and so on. But these people were looking for a war, or for that war, in order for them to be at the seat, at the top table, making the peace after the war was finished. Because they had already started planning for post-war order, actually, in 1939, when America was not even in the war and had very little prospect of it. And this is where I think elite knowledge networks have a limitation. but they're also very powerful. They have a limitation in that they, by themselves, they're not capable of achieving power, but they need some real-world catastrophe or crisis. When suddenly the lunacy of declaring war on Germany in 1940 is converted into the common sense on December the 8th, 1941. That is, you are safe because you're Canada to the north, Mexico to the south, Atlantic and Pacific to east and west. Who can touch you? And suddenly, Pearl Harbor says, the long-range bomber or whatever it is coming for you. So you need these sort of crises. And it's interesting when you look at the Project for a New American Century. In September 2000, their paper, Rebuilding America's Defenses, September 2000, we need a massive program of rearmament and so on and so forth in this paper. It's interesting, they say, we need Americans are too complacent about the lost positions and so on, and it says, we need a catastrophic, violent attack like Pearl Harbor in order to wake us up, because we've been sleepwalking through history since the collapse of the Soviet Union, and we've been drifting away from our mission and so on in the world. So these networks are incredibly powerful, but they always need a trigger. The lunatics who were talking in September 9, 2000 about a massive rearmament program and effectively a war on terror, lunatics in September 2000 talking effectively common sense by September the 12th, 2001, the key thing is that they had their networks ready, that they had done the intellectual groundwork, they've created a sort of an opinion on the margins that suddenly world events, they could make it appear as if they were the world events and moving in the direction they had always warned. And I think that's one of their greatest strengths. So when we get to this point of, yes, 5 minutes. 5 minutes, okay. So when we get to the 2016 election, what we see then is, and I was quite shocked in my own way, that what you've got is from the left and the right, a kind of rejection of Wall Street. The very institutions of Wall Street corporations and so on have funded for decades upon decades. You've got the Council on Foreign Relations at the very heart of that establishment. You've got Ford, Rockefeller, Carnegie, the kind of traditional big three. You've got the Gates and the Zuckerbergs, who are the sort of neoliberal era philanthropies called philanthrocapitalism, according to The Economist. That is, they want to make a profit, an actual profit, out of philanthropy as opposed to a sort of a different kind of model of it. You've got all this kind of system, and suddenly you've got Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders from different points of view, different angles, challenging that very system, such that these elite networks look as if they're in a crisis everywhere. They think, oh, I mean, I was involved in a Chatham House Rules type meeting with the outgoing British ambassador to the United States on January the 8th, 2016, where with a number of other very sort of experts who were completely discredited by November the 8th, 2016, where we were talking about the possibility of a Donald Trump presidency. And one of the things that somebody said there was, my greatest duty that I look forward to is introducing President Trump to Prime Minister Corbyn. And we all heartily laughed. And half of that had already come true. That is to say, it's a shock to the system that this individual. And so it seems to have bucked the entire trend, but when we look at what has happened since the election, and even if you like before the election, and we do this sort of Venn diagrams of think tanks, and it's very interesting to use think tanks as an institution. If you, because they are sort of acting in the world and thinking about the world and trying to combine the two in various ways, they are proxies for a kind of civil servants, in the America's own peculiar sense, because they have this state with democracy, or a non-state with democracy. And so they develop a kind of private network of institutions which approximate what in Western Europe were civil services. So these think tanks, that whole community of think tanks in New York and Washington, D.C., it's interesting to map these sort of people and what the papers they produce and what their role they play in the campaigns of the candidates, because they give you an idea about the kind of thinking that may be underlying it. And when we look at Trump, although he stood against all of that rhetorically, he actually is very close to the Heritage Foundation. And in the summer of 2016, it was interesting that he appointed Ed Buehlner, who was the founder and president of the Heritage Foundation, to the head of his transition team, which I found actually, to me, I was quite surprised. And since then, I actually plotted onto a graph. I don't know how to do PowerPoints. All the different institutions, all the different think tanks that his appointees, his advisors, people close to him, and we see a very similar pattern to John McCain in 2008, to Mitt Romney's in 2012, and to George W. Bush in 2000. They're slightly different from the Clintonian, but the Council on Foreign Relations remains central to most of them. They err on the side of Heritage Foundation, some from the Cato Institution, which is this isolationistic kind of libertarian institution. But there is Brookings, there's the CFR, there's the Center for Strategic and International Studies, and so on. That is to say, this is, if you like, that section of the establishment which grew from the 1970s in the aftermath of Vietnam and rejected the liberal establishment and wanted to create a new conservative establishment to rival that liberal establishment, but in effect is an extension to the right of that liberal establishment itself. And they generally share quite a wide range of concepts about the idea of American power, the nature of American power. They divide only on the means to be used to achieve those outcomes. So Trump is interesting because he is probably the first president who, he's not the first president, General Eisenhower also had not held elective political office, but he's certainly one of the most maverick individuals to get into the White House in a campaign against the establishment itself. So I would argue that the establishment, it's still early. A friend of mine who's attended the Atlantic Council meetings under Chatham House rules, but has told me everything that's gone on there by email, it's really interesting. These Republican congressmen who are pro-Trump have showed up to the Atlantic. I mean, the Atlantic Council is the heart of the NATO kind of epistemic community or hegemony or whatever you want to call it. And their idea about Putin is very far from what Donald Trump has been talking about from throughout the campaign. They are at great pains to reassure the hardcore element of that post-1945 world order and its key institutions. Donald Trump is rowing back furiously, in practice, from those positions that which inspired those so-called conservative, respectable conservative Republicans who had backed the Iraq war to the hilt back in 2003 and had supported Guantanamo and drone warfare. Those respectable conservatives were attacking Donald Trump as a racist warmonger unfit to hold elective office as president of the United States. So they are all running back to his administration to help Donald Trump to manage America, because it's too significant and important a project to be left to somebody to ruin. So elite networks, this incredibly interesting and powerful technology, is what I would argue is the principal achievement of the kind of these foundations and other elements which have developed forms of thought and embedded them in institutions and made them very adaptable, enduring, such that they can withstand what looked like a series of shocks from left to right. But in the end, I think, I'll finish with this, is that what these people have done, what Donald Trump has done, is it's papered over, not actually solved the crisis and the problem of the American establishment and of that order. Papered it over. He's managed to come to the head of that movement and to then shift it. What I would be very interested in is the full range of his appointments, the policy statements that he makes in a variety of areas, domestic and foreign, and then these rallies that he likes to hold. He's on a thank you trip recently. I'd like to see how many rallies last the full 4 years of his hopefully it's the last term, but the first four years, because I think attendance at those rallies is going to go down, and he may not hold them anymore, because the very people that he's been championing, he has been selling them out since about July, actually. He's been selling them out bit by bit, and the Heritage Foundation has produced this document from which Trump is drawing large amounts of his domestic and foreign policy. It's called the Blueprint for Reform. If you will recall, Heritage in 1980 produced the Mandate for Leadership, a 1,300-page document which Ronald Reagan used from which to draw large parts of his policies. They produced this thing called the Blueprint for Reform, and Donald Trump has already taken America's military policy straight out of the Blueprint for Reform for the Heritage Foundation. And that military policy is building a bigger navy than America's had since the Reagan era. It's going to build a bigger army than it's ever had. It's going to build a bigger Marine Corps. It's going to build a bigger Air Force and a bigger cyber capacity than before. That is to say, that new order under Donald Trump looks very much like the old order that Hillary Clinton full squarely was in favor of. And these elite networks, I think, can continue to operate.
Okay, thank you. Well, it's always a pleasure to listen to this articulate man. And I just pick him up on the last thing about the rallies that Trump is going to convene. How long will they last? I think they will last very long, except that at some point Trump will not be there anymore, and it will be rallies against Trump. And the basis for that movement has already been laid by some random, you know, in Oakland and other places in the United States which have a tradition of, what in the U.S. they call liberalism. Now, it is also a good reminder for us, and that's my first point, of what the term populism actually stands for. What I learned at school, always with the example of Latin America, of course, is that populists are those like Perón, etc., who rule in the name of the people, but with a special concern to make sure that the people themselves will never be a subject of exercising power. So it's acting in the name of the people and then doing what a particular ruling class bloc wants to achieve. So in that sense, it shouldn't be a shock for us that Trump is reneging on its promises. He is a populist in the classical sense. He mobilizes the people in the name of some abstract essential entity, and then reintroduces the ruling class program, although it may still contain a number of surprises. I was surprised when you mentioned that Ed Fielder is the head of the transition team.
No, he was to the transition team.
But that in itself is very interesting, because not only is Fielder at the origin of the Heritage Foundation, but he was also the treasurer of the Mont Pelerin Society, which is the bulwark of the austerity people. So in that sense, we also see continuity there. Now, then to Inderjeet's real major topic, the foundations, on which he has written this fantastic book. The foundations indeed mark the moment when individual capitalists have reached the stage where their power as a successful businessman has to be translated into class power. And the United States tax legislation has given them a fantastic opportunity to do that by organized tax evasion, because the moment you turn your private wealth into foundation wealth, it's no longer taxed because you're doing a public service. Of course, you also relinquish something of your direct control of what your power actually is meant to achieve. And that is the foundation may at some point reach a stage where, as Inderjeet knows better than I, the Ford Foundation was criticized by the son of Henry Ford, if I'm not mistaken, for being too socialistic. But there exactly do you see what is the ability of the ruling class to rule, at least in the liberal Lockean constellation of the West. And that is the point that Inderjeet made already. It's non-sectarian attitude. Its ability to really bring in everybody who is who can be remotely considered as not even as corrupt, but as willing to think along lines that are not based in some militant anti-establishment attitude. So, for instance, when Woodrow Wilson's representative at the end of the First World War came to Europe and promised American aid, etc., for reconstruction, there was a whole hall of politicians from Europe present, and they all roared in applause and jumped to their feet. But there was one figure sitting on the margin, and that was Vladimir Lenin, and he didn't even applaud, because he was on the opposite side. But he should, at that moment, already have realized that he was also completely isolated, because everybody who was flexible and who was willing to think along unusual lines was already sold to the Wilsonian program. Now, that step from individual capitalist power to class power through foundations, which means that you begin to influence what is taught in universities, to influence what is written in the op-ed columns of the newspaper, at some point produces an ideological structure that is capable of maintaining itself over a decade or several decades. And, well, with my friends in Amsterdam, we came to the notion of a concept of control, that basically you have a whole set of interlocked ideological tenets, and they allow you to set the limits of the possible, to set the limits of the thinkable, for everybody, even for those who are in opposition, unless you have your own integrated alternative program. But there's one enormously important aspect of every concept of control or ideological structure or hegemonic project, however you want to call it, and that is it has to have a material component. There has to be not just ideological concessions, not just a matter of phrases that people will enjoy hearing, there has to be income for people. There has to be a profit distribution coming out of the whole capitalist economy, which rewards those groups that are willing to subscribe to this particular concept. Otherwise, it cannot become comprehensive and cover all aspects of social reproduction. When Inderjeet says the foundations are again in the process of restabilizing the system, they will do so in words, with phrases, with catchy ideological narratives. But what is failing is a material reward, because the degrowth movement that Leslie spoke about is in fact very successful, because if you take growth as a synonym for capital accumulation, we are already degrowing. You know, the basis for real capitalist capital accumulation is falling away, and that means that the concept of control today is what Gramsci called corruzione and fraud. You know, it's corruption and fraud. If people are told lies about threats that are not real threats, etc., etc., without material rewards coming their way. And that's exactly the setting in which populism flourishes, because now you need politicians to actually disseminate these fraudulent messages. Now, even in the 1970s, and there again, Inderjeet spoke about the Trilateral Commission being the body through which concessions were made to the new international economic order, and I've always felt that this is an understudied aspect of international politics, you know, because it was such a confused movement, it didn't respond to the sort of romantic idea that we had of Third World Revolution. It was all very bourgeois, etc. And what you say, this was a body which acted internationally in the way the ruling class acts nationally, and that is by incorporating opposing forces who are willing to think roughly along your lines. And here, concessions were made internationally. Again, the same applies. If in the 1970s it was still possible, on the basis of inflation at that time, to get industrialization programs going in many third world and actually the Soviet bloc countries, today that basis for making concessions has fallen away. And I think for me that is really the, well, I've been listening carefully these 2 days, and what has come out for me is that I feel reinforced in the notion that we are facing a crisis that can only be compared to the crisis at the end of World War One, World War One already being part of the crisis, and that therefore the time has passed, or the time has expired, in which we can still project future strategies that will need decades to mature, and you know where we're going to mobilize the people that will still be able to do something about steering clear of catastrophe must be here now. Their mental universe must be present. We must be able to discern it, and without trying to flatter you now, you are part of this, because I think, as I just said in my question to Leslie, I do think that the people who wanted to work for Apple, and I put it a bit anecdotally, it's my last slide. The people who wanted to work for Apple, who wanted to work for Google, who were trained by the thousands at universities and all kinds of education institutions to do that, but who then are thrown away as rejects, because although they have all the qualifications, but they are not part of that employment, they don't enjoy that employment opportunity, they are the ones, in my view, that who will function as organic intellectuals at some point of the that is the intellectuals that come about almost spontaneously, although of course they have to form themselves as intellectuals, as alternative leaders of the people who will very soon feel themselves deceived by the Trumps, by the leaders of the Brexit movement, and of course South Europe is a very interesting area in this respect, as the Italian know reminds us. Latin America is very important, and we can only hope that there will not be a major war, which is actually being stoked up in Ukraine and in, of course, the Middle East. I don't have to tell you any news here, to intervene with hopefully what will be a slow process, necessarily happening within a few years, otherwise its time will already have expired too, to steer these masses back to, let's say, the Bernie Sanders form, because I also think the 13 million that you referred to are a crucial factor. Thank you.
So now we have about an hour for comments, questions. We have microphones for anyone who wants to raise a hand and contribute, starting with Dan, and then we'll come to Francesca and again and Leslie.
So two fascinating presentations and very, very thought-provoking. I should preface my comment by saying that I also would like to hope that the 13 million votes for Sanders will have a more enduring consequentiality in the US political situation. But as I see it, the issue of ruling class consensus, meaning the formation of an evolving structure of opinion outside of which it is illegitimate to go in the mainstream, has moved in spasms to the right ever since World War II in episodes. So I would like to wonder, I suppose, if we can think a little bit more about whether once the I don't think it's fair to say they're the people who might have been hired by Apple only. I mean, those are not the only Trump voters. The Trump voters are the, as you said, the Rust Belt whites, and even beyond. So
I'd like to ask about where it will be possible once the reality of the new administration is actualized. And I share almost entirely the sense that you've expressed of where it is going, where it will be. We're in a state of suspended animation for the next, till January 20th, you know, but then it will suddenly be in place. Where will it be possible to go without a more overtly authoritarian structure of control? I don't see how this kind of crisis can be effectively contained in the United States itself, and I'm speaking within the United States itself, without a more authoritarian structure. And I would like to, because we have sociologists here, I'm not one, but I admire some sociologists. One of them I admire was Robert Lind. Robert Lind was an early mid-20th century American sociologist, and he wrote in a book that still commends itself, I think, today, by a different writer, a political economist named Robert Brady, whose name is forgotten because he was destroyed by McCarthyism. Robert Brady wrote a book in 1943 called Business as a System of Power. And that book compared the power structure of big business, mostly through trade associations, in six or seven advanced capitalist countries, and purported to show that that structure of power was very comparable between Japan and Germany on the one side, and the United States and Britain on the other. So in the middle of World War II, that was a difficult lesson. But Lind, in his foreword to the book, he said, and this was a common observation through the mid-30s and into the 40s in the United States, Adorno expressed a different Horkheimer, a different version of it, Sinclair, or Lewis, the novelist, a different version of it. If fascism comes, said Lind, I'm paraphrasing, but not by much, to the United States, it will come in the full trappings of democracy. And to me, Trump is as close as we have come to this kind of a formulation. So I guess I'm wandering, but I'd like your opinions on it.
Okay. Can we bring Mike over here for Francesca?
Yeah. Okay. I think I'll say something obvious, but so my first comment to what I heard is, and in particular to the people here from Spain, to the comrades that are here and Europe, I do actually find really imprescindible this analysis of what I think it's the way that the state is being transformed. I mean, I think you are describing, I mean, not only this power network foundation and think tanks, how they are linked. I mean, if you want to take into account the follow the money thing, the follow the money to understand how power works, how then they are linked to corporations, what is the role of the media, what is the role of the international institutions like the World Bank and the IMF, which are really linked into boosting these elite networks, how the corporate boards appointments and government appointments are completely linked to this network, and how decision-making operate in this kind of total rip-off of the people into shifting money to these elites. And I mean, I don't know, I mean, I'm now really going to read your book immediately. I'm sorry I haven't done.
Not really.
But anyways, and I think, you know, whoever, I mean, I don't care if it's this local government or national, but whoever is now saying that we have to take the state or the institution or something has to go through this analysis. I mean, I think this kind of analysis for us and for any person which is involved into the transformation of the system has to be the basics, because if we don't know what is going on, how can we claim we're transforming it? I don't like, and anyways, I don't think this is fully happening, and I think we have to rethink, and I mean, I'm sure there is a lot of problem into how do we draw resources to allow, you know, this kind of analysis to happen, link it with where the people are transforming society, if it's in their social movements or their political parties or the newly formed, whatever, progressive parties that want to run progressive governments, we need to link it up with this kind of analysis. Because, you know, we cannot operate otherwise. So this is a reflection. I think I would like to emphasize that I think on the technology side, what worries us, and we didn't do proper analysis, but clearly I've been involved a lot into that, so I know it by like through my work. There is a new actor, which is exactly Silicon Valley and the digital, which is very much operating like this. And I think it's operating like this extremely effectively. And we can see not only that foundation, I mean, you haven't mentioned Soros, which is a big player. I mean, I'm sure it's in your book, and anyways, it's linked to these other networks. But, you know, not only they are very influential in the elite, I think that today the thing is they're shaping movements. And it's not only, you know, they're putting people in power in Davos or in trilateral commission. No, they're actually shaping movements. And movements of radical youth and people which you describe here, which are educated, whatever, they're really embedded into this foundation. And then the foundation, how they link with the corporation. I mean, yesterday, Evgeny said something like, every privacy researcher is funded by Google. Yeah, either Google or some of these other foundations that anyway are funding all the work and shaping the agenda very much so. And so we are not reflecting enough. And if you look at the strategic, just to say, because you said it's a mix of international relations, positive social science, which is an obsession for these people, and they keep, you know, randomized controlled trials, behavioral economics, game theory, you name it. And then the strategic regions in the world, clearly in Europe, is more difficult to see the role of this foundation in operating. But if you look like Latin America, regime change, of course, that's the agenda. And you know that's how they're using these new movements, and this is very dangerous. And I don't think we have enough awareness, and I don't think we're working at all enough on this, and I think this is very important.
Just to maybe formulate what Francesca said in the first half of the comment, I think to some extent many of the movements, including radical movements, that are taking power, you know, they kind of enter the state and they discover that the state is empty. In a sense, because it's run by big four consulting firms, foundations, and all the rest of it. Right? So in a sense, I think it's something that we need to contend with, because it's a problem that you immediately run into once you take power. You know, we kind of talked about it when we talked about the central bank yesterday and what happened to Syriza, but I think we need to be much deeper in mapping who actually runs the state, right? And the way in which foundations fit into it. I just wanted to say something else, a couple of things actually. Inderjeet was very modest, but he's also part of a very interesting project called Elite Power Investigations Center, I believe, right? I encourage all of you to Google it and go to the website, which I think is quite interesting effort to actually map out how all of these elites cohere, what institutions they belong to, fantastic graphs somewhere on the website. Maybe you can say also a bit more about what you're trying to achieve with that. A couple of other things. I think it would be interesting to reflect on the fact that Trump also seems to be the first president with his own foundation, however fake, fictitious, and predatory it actually is. It would be actually curious to know what it tells us about the state of foundations now that a guy can claim to be running a foundation without seemingly spending any money on it and just using it as a way to create his own brand and promote his own celebrity. On the question of philanthropic capitalism, which Inderjeet, you mentioned in passing, I think it would be interesting to know whether you think that its rationale is limited just to making money, or whether there is some kind of deeper project of consciousness engineering, if you will, of trying to create entrepreneurs, which is what we have been discussing. Also, you know, Andres mentioned it, we mentioned it this morning, because my impression of philanthropic capitalism is that not only is it a way to, you know, unlock some of the, you know, bottom of the pyramid, as the leading propagandists of this would put it, but it's also a way to basically instill a particular subjectivity into its subjects, with the foundations picking up the bill. So in a sense, even if they do not make any money, they still succeed, because the goal is ultimately to create that subjectivity. And the two last points that I want to make is, would be good to see, I don't know if you've done any empirical work on this, would be good to see how and whether the European ruling classes and billionaires have incorporated some of the lessons of the Americans. Because, you know, if you look at Germany, correct me if I'm wrong, I think Germany actually has more billionaires in an absolute numbers as a country than the United States. Despite all that sort of claim to social equality and whatnot, there are just a lot of billionaires in Germany. Many of them now run their own foundations, which I don't think was the case 20 or 30 years ago when much of the foundations were still linked to political parties. Now you actually have a lot of personal private wealth financing a lot of it. And I'm just curious if we know anything about their methods of operations. And the final point, linking to also what Francesca has said, you know, we've privately sort of been playing with this idea that what the left, you know, if you can still talk about the left at this point, really lacks as not just, you know, good propaganda, good think tanks, you know, good party system. What it really lacks is some kind of McKinsey of the left, where you actually have operational experience that can maybe create some of these elite networks for its own use, but can also actually come and deal with the fact that the state is empty, what I said at the beginning. Even if you take power, you have no operational capacity to do anything because it has all been shifted outside of the state in Big Four, in McKinsey, in foundations. And if that really is the diagnosis, then the question to me is, how do you go about preparing for the future when that remote possibility comes that you do take power? How do you sort of construct the basic elements of this McKinsey of the left, given that probably you cannot count on, you know, just taking over a corporation and using it for those purposes?
Do you want to, or you want to take some more questions? Up to you.
Well, you're the chairman.
No, we're very flexible.
There's a lot of questions already.
Why don't we go around?
Take them in short groups, it's easier.
Yeah, okay. Thank you, my teacher.
You're no longer as young as you used to.
Still look quite young. The Brady Lind. Fantastic. Both Robert Lind and Robert S. Lind and Robert F. Brady, I guess. They both came up in the archival work I did on their various grant applications. And I remember an application for Robert Lind's book, Knowledge. He'd already written Knowledge for What? In 1940, I think, 39-40. And there's these foundation reports on his, he makes an application to Carnegie and to Rockefeller. He's saying, we're fighting a war against fascism. And the last thing we want is unbridled chauvinism at home, you know, and locking people up and vilifying Germans and others like we did in World War I. We want to fight a war against fascism, which will strengthen the institutions of democracy. And therefore, we need the state to subsidize kind of liberal anti-fascist organizations and kind of more leftist. It's unbelievable, because mostly the foundations destroy grant applications which are rejected. But here, there's fragments. It's almost like doing archaeological work. There are about 20 pages, fragmentary, because of some fire or flood or something, of the referee's reports and the internal discussion about this democracy strengthening anti-fascist application. They just actually smashed him to pieces. Who is this do-gooding sociologist? What do you think war is? War is to kill people. The whole point of our funding is to train people to be ready to kill. What this guy wants is the state to subsidize democracy and so forth. It's rubbish. Yeah. Now, of the 24 referees to whom they sent this, which is also unprecedented, 21 actually said this is the best project I've ever read. And Charles Beard was one of them, which I suspect was the kiss of death. Charles Beard was the kind of enemy of these kind of foundations anyway. But these were very few people who applied from outside of that kind of thinking. And this was one example of how it is treated. These big foundations effectively are the most significant gatekeepers of who should have a voice. But when they decide that you ought to have a voice, even for an innovative idea, or what looks like a radical idea, it could be freedom, it could be human rights, it could be women's rights in Afghanistan, it could be whatever looks really significant at that particular time, key thing is that they choose who should get the money. They choose the definition of the problem and the method of studying and research and the form of the solution and with whom that those people, those groups, are to be networked. And if they like what they see, then they will buy the first 3,000 copies of your book in order to make sure it gets up to the top of the New York Times bestseller list. And it will then become adopted on various courses. So what the network does, if you like, as a multiplier effect, is relatively small. There's not many people there. But what it does do, it says, well, Harvard is teaching this now. But everybody else thinks, well, if Harvard's doing it, then 100 other universities which don't have the resource now put resource into that way of thinking, whether it's geopolitics or whatever else it might be. So the network remains very powerful, and I think this is also addresses Francesca's point, that you have wonderful numbers of people in the human race in all walks of life who want change, whether it's well-fed people like me who still think it's unjust the way things go on, or whether it's people who are not fed enough who want to change it. That is going on. That doesn't matter what academics or anybody else says, that is happening. The key thing is that the foundations also know that this is going on. And what they want to do is they want to make sure that aspiration for change is not locked into a particular outcome, but they're willing to come to you and say, oh, we like your ideas. Here's a program that you could do. It could be called human rights or whatever. And what effectively often happens to the most progressive people in social sciences is that they become part of that agenda against their will, but because it happens to be a part of what they want. So I'll give you a good example. George McTernan Kahin, who was an Indonesia studies scholar at Cornell, who wrote a wonderful book called U.S. Foreign Policy, a Subversion, major critic of the Vietnam War, was actually head of the Modern Indonesia program at Cornell, funded entirely by Ford. The original name of that program was called The Sources of Soviet Sabotage or something in Indonesia. That was the actual name, and he looked at that name and he said, I can't use that. So they said, okay, we'll call it the Modern Indonesia Project. But what was the content of that program was effectively to say nationalism is the problem in Indonesia. Communism was the public face of the critique of nationalism. And the idea was that there was an anti-colonial character to it because Indonesia was a Dutch colony, or a former colony. So on the basis of a progressive academic's anti-colonialism and a desire to create a free country, newly out of colonialism, you give large funds to George McTernan Kahin and his program, and he ends up studying the biographies of the leadership of the Communist Party, the structure of political power at the village level, including who are the most respected people in the village, who are the most listened to people, including the chief of police, and in connecting the national to the local, because their critique of the Indonesian elite was mainly trained in Holland or Britain or United States and don't know anything about village life. We will fuse the urban and the village. And when it came to 1966, when a lot of other things had happened, not just, we know about the Chicago boys, but not many people have heard of the beautiful Berkeley boys, who were Indonesian, who were catapulted to power with Suharto and formed his economic team and so on. That is, a progressive academic who is anti-American imperialism is recruited to a program whose underlying basis is a subversion of nationalism on the basis of his anti-colonialism and ends up actually delivering an outcome which he had no intention of delivering. And that's the kind of, if you like, the strength I was talking about, these networks. They're willing to talk to anybody who's got a glimpse of an idea which resonates with their own. But because they have this sort of, which is where the difference between philanthrocapitalism and this corporate philanthropy of the old style comes in, is that they don't have any shareholders. They don't have any electors. They just have large pots of money. And they have boards of trustees who have the, you know, it's a bit like being an aristocrat with large amounts of money. You can afford to fail and still remain very rich and powerful. So they have, they'll back loads of projects. They don't know what the outcome's going to be, but they know the kind of thing that they'd like. So they have large amounts of money that they've put a few $100,000 into here and there. One of those 100 comes through as a success in some form. Area studies, strategic studies, international relations, or whatever it might be, and particular programs. And some of those programs are actually overtly emancipatory and progressive. But they have this edge of kind of bringing the progressive into a part of the system which actually kind of delivers sometimes the opposite of what the progressive intended. That to me is one of the most kind of tragic things about it. So while I would not say that you should not get funding from anybody who's willing to give it to you, but you have the vigilance levels and how your kind of independence can be and integrity can be compromised has always to be borne in mind, that everybody who has resource has an agenda, that we do as well. And that we should not forget that they have a political agenda. And the consciousness of that makes you then possibly conscious of to what extent to give of yourself to that particular kind of agenda. Philanthrocapitalism is of a different order in some ways. Although Bill Gates, when he wanted to set up his foundation, went to Vartan Gregorian, who is the president of the Carnegie Corporation, and who owes his historical ideological allegiance to Andrew Carnegie and the gospel of wealth. And all of these people think God gave them that money, and Bill Gates is no different. If you listen to his Reith lectures in 2013 on the BBC, where he, I mean, talk about a saint coming to London for the great and the good, talking about how saintly and godly he is. When you look underneath, you know, the health programs of the Gates Foundation, and what they do to kind of wreck indigenous health systems, to go completely round it, and to introduce big pharma into those processes, or into the agricultural, AGRA, Alliance for a Green Revolution in Africa, to sort of bestow upon Africans that which they missed out in the 1960s. You look at the programs which involve Monsanto and other big corporations, you find that they're doing something that most of us would, on the face of it, would really support. Who would not support people not getting, you know, vaccines or immunizations or whatever? Or who would not solve the problem of hunger in various societies? But the way in which they go about it is actually strengthening of the market relations, of denial of other kinds of relations and relationships and so on. They're actually building the kind of work that they want. And this goes to the point that you made about entrepreneurs. I think maybe you are right. I think what they are trying to create is the kind of people who will be able to survive in a relatively, not without a state, but in a different concept of the state. The state fully armed to the teeth to kill you or incarcerate you or to discipline you, draw new boundaries for behavior, which actually says you're on your own until you cross this line, and then you're out. And you could be in a private prison run by an entrepreneur of some form who also had to make a living. So there is a hollowing out of the state, if you like, and a new concept of the state. As a result of your invitation, I actually had to read a book, and I discovered a book written in 2009 by Janine Wedel, who is an anthropologist at what I think the neocons thought was going to be their first university as part of the conservative establishment, George Mason, which is partly. She's an anthropologist there, and she's written a book called Shadow Elite. I think if you look at that book, actually she, 7 years ago, prefigured a lot of this. She did a lot of her training and study and living in Poland, where you have a kind of delegitimized order within which people live under the shadow of a state, where they effectively make their own little communities which survive despite the state and outside of the state, that they manage to get things. But what they do is they create close-knit communities and closed communities which somehow survive this and subvert the elements of the state. And what she argues in the book is that when she returned to the United States, that she found actually the delegitimization of the American political system was so deep that people were becoming more and more privatized in themselves. And then when I looked at, from that book to what she's been writing about the American election, she argued, and this is where the technological bit, which I left out because I don't care about with other stuff, was that actually the technology, you know, social networks or whatever, Twitter and stuff, which were used very widely and deeply and so on long before Trump, but in particular ways by Trump, actually have created these close-knit, closed-minded communities in the United States as well, where you go to get your truth confirmed. And Stephen Colbert, or whoever he is, she says, invented a term called truthiness. We talk about post-truth politics and post-fact politics. Apparently this concept of truthiness has been going around for a little while, which is basically the fact which sounds true to you, and which you then repeat, and you can find lots of examples of as soon as you go into the little communities, mental communities we construct via social networks. And in a way, I think in this election in particular, where you can have claims made which are so outlandish, but yet believed by millions of people, Trump didn't invent this. Is it Karl Rove who told Ron Susskind, New York Times, you guys live in the reality-based community, and you believe you can study its form, it exists out there in the real world, you study it, you report on it, and meanwhile, we've said something else and created a new reality, which you will then respond to. It's a kind of postmodernism. It says what we say and believe is true is true. It's by true by virtue of us having said it, and it becomes true. And the key thing is, when you look at the nature of American politics in particular, lots of things became true. Obama is a Muslim. He's an Arab. He's a terrorist. He's a half-Kenyan anti-colonial. Even his birth certificate, as in the reality-based community, a real birth certificate isn't really real. It's something missing. Look, you know, you can construct it. And Donald Trump was at the forefront of some of those kind of things. So I think Janine Waddell has already talked about the kind of, and what she says about the state, and she calls these people flexmen, and she takes it straight out of Poland and East Central Europe, is that after the fall of the wall, and the kind of not collapse of the state, but the change of the state, what you get is all sorts of people doing all kinds of roles on a sort of part-time basis, going in and out of what used to be called the state, even constituting the state. These consultants who will do one thing here, something else over there, and so on. So I think that probably is the future of the Western state, is to be a sort of small machine, disciplining at the very center, armed to the teeth, with some ideological system around it, but largely disciplinary, but allowing these so-called entrepreneurs linked with various kinds of corporations to construct an entrepreneurial subject who will have to look after themselves.
But that was the New Labour vision for building the network state and the joined-up government. Mm. I mean, it's by design, it's not just just a spontaneous project. Right.
But then we go on with the tendency of the left.
Just two footnotes for clarification. Dan said the tech wizards who are not employed by Google were not the people who elected Trump. I didn't mean to say that. The people who elect Trump are the ones you say. But since Pierre Bourdieu, we know that most people cannot form an integral picture of the world, a worldview. And organic intellectuals do that, so they emerge with that mass and they provide a sort of integral narratives. And I do think that the activists and WikiLeaks and Snowden are really markers of that sort of organic intellectual stratum, which is now coming up. And the important thing is that they are unemployed, highly trained, able to run the show if they only had the chance. Now that is what you call a counter a revolutionary elite. Now the other footnote is what Yevgeny said, what do we get when we capture the state? And it's an empty thing, etc. That's true. You see that in, and it's actually a source of populism, because the people again feel deceived when left-wing parties like, for instance, Die Linke in Germany take over state, province governments, as they have done now, I think in Mecklenburg, I'm not sure. And I've spoken to people who know the ones who are now ministers there, and they turn out to be an enormous deception. Why? Because they find when they take office that there are already packs of long-lasting agreements that have been signed for well over their own incumbency. So when Leslie said, you shouldn't engage with the market, you shouldn't be captured by market and do business with market forces, I think that's an impossible proposition.
Yeah.
But you can say we won't take public office, simply because we know how the state is being run, in the way that was yesterday made clear about the central bank. So I think it's exactly the opposite. You have to accept that the only real economy that exists is a mostly market economy. It's dominated by, how else would we be worrying about capitalism? But you can resist the temptation of taking public office and all the glamour that comes with it, because then you are really a captive of something that is completely opposite to what you intended to achieve.
Okay, so that brings us to Leslie's comment or question.
Okay.
Can we get a mic over?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, right here. Sorry. We'll come to you in a moment. And then over here. Yeah. Okay, sorry, we got a lot of hands.
I think there is a tension that emerged yesterday and as well as today between two perspectives, even if I'm going to simplify them. But from one side, there is a tendency to, let's say, emphasize the continuities and the capacity of the elites to maintain the control of the crisis. And on the other side, there is Kees that yesterday and today again now provided a different perspective, saying we are on the edge of some way a catastrophic change, because the elites are losing in some way the control of the process and of the crisis. I think this is a tension that should be more thought and about, and I think it's a real issue we should think about. I would like just to make two references to two authors that I think can help to think this possibility that Kees suggested, that are from one side Giovanni Arrighi and his theory of the long cycles of accumulation, that I think are useful to try to understand the kind of crisis we enter. And the other is Polanyi, Karl Polanyi, and the idea that we are, and this is quite spread, no? Nowadays, the recovery of Polanyi, the idea that we are entering a sort of new counter-movement, as he called, not so a crisis of the first globalization, as it was, no? The crisis that Polanyi reflected about. So in that sense also, it would be interesting to reflect about the role of this hegemonic structures, now that you have been talking about the foundations, because in some way they have been protagonists of the American century, they have been the protagonists of the world Keynesian and post-World War order, and I wonder if they are able really to maintain this capacity of what to think about some discontinuity also in that sense, for reasons which can be geopolitical, for reasons which can be also, as Francesco was saying, related with the new mode of production that is emerging through the digital revolution. And so, for example, these new players and the new sites of accumulation that are emerging, they are different from not these foundations. They were rooted in the big corporations that dominated the industrial period. And finally, well, there will be many things to discuss about, but finally, there is one element that I think would be interesting to reflect about, taking, for example, Polanyi, as a, an inspiration, which is the idea that the counter movement is, according to Polanyi, is characterized by a request of diffused request of people of protection, no? Because of the extreme commercialization and the chaos that is producing all over the across the society, no? And so, in some way, that makes thinking that there is a possibility of a return of the state, no? This is what Polanyi was thinking about. We know how difficult it is to think about a return of the state in these conditions, but somebody else raised this issue, and I think it's a real issue. And Trump or Sanders or whatever, now this new kind of insurgent policies, politics, let's say, are calling for some kind of protection, no? And of state intervention. I don't know what that could mean. And the last issue also that I wanted to raise is about these catastrophic attacks, no, that you were referred in the two moments, no, in two critical moments of crisis. And I wonder if we are not on the edge of a possible catastrophic attack that is going to arrive on the digital layer of our society. So an attack that would be functional to this authoritarian time, that could be a possible new step in this evolution of the crisis we are living through.
I think we have Chris next. Yeah.
I just wanted to really thank you for your work. And as someone based in the United States, I think it had to be someone outside of the United States to do this work, because I feel that people are either willingly ignorant or actually afraid to critique, especially these foundations. And I think it's something that just doesn't happen in the United States.
Apart from Anthony's father.
Yes. It happens not nowhere near enough. One of the lessons I do take from your looking at the role that these, you know, foundations and think tanks play is I think that paradoxically, the American ruling class, as expressed through these networks of institutions, have a much greater understanding of the importance of cadre than anyone on the left does. And I think that they, all of those institutions have internship programs, they have scholarship funds, they, you know, there's revolving doors where they train people who become journalists, who become scholars, who, you know, work in the State Department, all levels of government. And they put, you know, real time, real energy, real resources into developing the cadres they need that come out of these networks. And I do think that's something that we could actually learn from that. I did have a question for you about the possible declining influence of these networks. I mean, in terms of Obama's foreign policy, for instance, his you know, step away from Saudi Arabia and step towards Iran was certainly opposed by CFR and the consensus of these elite institutions. I think, you know, the fact that the U.S. is a lot less dependent on Saudi Arabian oil than it once was probably gave him some maneuvering room. But also, you know, they were much, much more hawkish on Syria than Obama was, and he resisted that to some extent. And so I feel like, I don't know, I'm wondering if you see that there's already some signs of that influence weakening, or, you know, what actually was it that allowed Obama to not fully take the CFR line in foreign policy? And then, you know, to me, the CFR crowd accepting a rapprochement with Russia seems insane. Like, it seems like they would never, ever accept that. But Trump seems like he's going for it. And what, you know, what do you see, you know, in terms of that? And then, just if I could just add one comment on the Trump election, I do think it's a little hasty to blame the Trump election on the white working class in the United States. That I think if you actually look at the election returns, if you compare this election to 4 years ago, Trump actually got between 1% and 2% less of the white vote than Romney did. He actually won more African American, more Latino, and more Asian Americans than Romney did. I think that the story of the election is more the people that stayed home on the Democratic side and did not turn out for Hillary. And if you compare, obviously, her numbers to Obama's, they're very, very low. And so I think, obviously there is a wave of right wing reaction and racist violence that's unleashed by the Trump election, which is no small thing. But I don't think that there was no evidence that there was a wave of white racist voters that turned out at the polls to vote for Trump. Basically, Republicans voted for Trump in the same way Republicans voted for Romney and voted for McCain, and like Republicans basically behaved like Republicans. It was on the Democratic side that Democratic turnout was much, much less because of a very uninspiring, flawed candidate. I would say has to have some piece of that. So I just wanted to interject that as well.
Over here, yeah. Oh, sorry, I thought you had a microphone already.
Yeah, I didn't take the glove that Francesca threw at the beginning, but if I have to take your words seriously, then I have to give up my job and I have to actually advise all my comrades to leave all the local governments around Spain, which I don't think is a really good idea. So maybe we can discuss what is this position of you shouldn't deal with the state in any way, or maybe the question is why we are thinking that it's a good idea to enter at least the local administrations, and some other comrades actually are going for regional and national elections as well. And actually that will make for me some sense, because even next week we are going to have a talk with people from New York City, which are thinking about setting up a local coalition, and there is also in this very moment people of Barcelona and Comune in Belgrade talking about exactly the same thing. So I think that there is, when we organize the citizen-based platforms to go for the elections in the local elections in Spain, we had the story, right? I mean, we knew what happened with the Socialist Party in this country, we knew what happened with the Green Party in Germany, we knew what happened with the progressive governments in Latin America. We knew that being in government doesn't mean to have the power, and yet still we decided to go for this. And so one of the reasons is that, and this maybe links also with the previous talk somehow, is what are we thinking that is a possible emancipatory project that is outside the state, if it is possible to think about it outside the state and the market? And actually, the answer, I think, right now is no. I've been working about the issue of the commons for many years, and we have to admit that most of the collective resources that are building up mutuality systems are nowadays on the hands of the state. And I don't think that we can actually build a separate health system or a separate education system or a separate housing system without reclaiming those, resources back. So what actually the history in what the last experience in Spain demonstrated is that even if you have, when we speak about awareness, right? Like what happened with the May 15 in Spain is that people was aware of the situation. People was aware that the crisis was a scam. People was aware that bankers and politicians were cheating us all. People were aware of a lot of things. And were experimenting in the street, in the squares, like another way of relations that made them think that you can organize in another way. After that, there was a huge wave of demonstrations, honestly, people were meeting once a week in Madrid, in the park, for more than a year to learn about economics, like normal people were discussing. Everybody knew what is this German kind of thing that shouldn't go more than 500,000 La prima de riesgo. Everybody knew what was la prima de riesgo. Everybody knew what the hell of this risk prime index in relation with the German debt was in any moment of the week. I mean, we knew if it was 400 1980, or if it was 600. I mean, people knew that, right? I mean, and people knew that because they thought it affected their lives. Not because there was some kind of leftist thing saying you should know this. This is ruling your life. If this goes more than 500, it will happen like Greece, and then we will have a new government here, and it's fucking up our lives. So that's why people knew these things, right? Okay, even though this happened, even though there were millions of people in the street in different moments all together, even like a normal neighborhood in the outskirts of Soria, which is, you know, a lost place in the middle of the plain in Spain, actually rioted and burned the machines that were closing the street. I mean, this was not black bloc, anarchists, kids, whatever. It was like normal people, you know, like middle class, rioting in the middle of the street. The government didn't change a bit. So what actually you're faced with this absolute impotence, because there is not a way to say, if you build, I mean, we used to think if you build a social force around an idea that has its current, you know, that you put there your demands and you have enough support, the government will have to listen to you and then they will have to react to you. Well, this is not working anymore. It didn't happen in Spain for 4 years. I mean, it didn't happen when 99% of the population in Spain was against the Iraq invasion, and it didn't happen after the May 15th with all this, you know, general consensus. So when you face this, you have to face the problem of the state. And you have actually to face also how in people's mind, the state and the public and what it represents with a lot of wage on the, in the case of Spain, the, not only the democracy, not only the culture of the transition, but also the building of a certain sense of democracy that has to do with the Republic and the French Revolution and so on and so forth. This is an image that is actually difficult to deconstruct on towards another way. So in this context, for us, it made all the sense to get into the institutions and try to change them, which is, as you can imagine, not an easy task, and I would very much like Raul and Carlos to be here and to be like a better, you know, more articulated from a much stronger experience on the state level. But basically, I think that, basically, so this is the point. This is the point, like, we have to recognize that there is a moment where either we make an armed revolution, or we try to deal with the state, if you want to change things, basically. I don't think that the idea that to create a totally alternative parallel system is going to work. Sorry, if anybody else has a better position, I mean, like, put it, I'm, you know, like, at this point, after 1 year and a half in a local government, I'm really, you know, able to take this idea and consider it seriously. Still, I don't think it is. This is one thing. The other thing is, I also think it is interesting to think our own fascination for our capacity to make a very specific description of all the powers and forces that are around us, and our incapacity to do the same thing with all the experiences that actually can take us out of this situation. Because we don't have the data, because all those, at the end of the day, all those foundations or whatever, all this machinery that is creating the knowledge, because it's fixed on their own system, it is easier for us to make further analysis on that system, which means that it's very difficult to drag data on any kind of other experiences. So, and this, I was part of this collective doing research on Madrid. I've been working on maps for a long time, and it is amazing the amount of super sophisticated mapping on all the neoliberal forces, all the problems. You know, you take the Bugotitude maps, and then, you know, you get fascinated by this capacity. But then when we try to actually map, track, and study the practices, you know, that have an emancipatory, you know, kind of potential, it's so difficult, but that very easily we just give up. And this has to do with a third point, which is, I agree with Francesca, it is basic to understand how all these forces, how the power and the elite brokers work, and how is the system. But we need translators,
that are able to take this super sophisticated analysis into some kind of practical, you know, positions that you can do from somewhere else in order to dismantle this machine. What I'm meeting is like an engineer knowing all the little pieces of this machinery is super useful. But honestly, at the end of the day, I need them to say, here is a screwdriver. If you go there, this thing is going to collapse. Because it is not useful if all of us are becoming these rocket engineers, you know, of everything that is fucking our lives. Because we also need to know what the hell we can do to get out of there. And we need this picture. I mean, this is a piece of the picture. This is a necessary, you know, piece of the mosaic. But how are we going to build something that people can attach to and can take in their lives and have the feeling that their lives are going to be better with what we are offering them? And I have the feeling that, honestly, the discourses explaining in such precise and detailed, you know, way, everything that is bad and all the incredible forces that are actually going to stop us to do what we need to do are good. But we need the rest of the story. And honestly, we need translators. We need translators to your analysis to, okay, there's all the foundations and everything there. If we want to have the attention or whatever strategy, I don't know what it's called, I don't even know who they are. Mackenzie or whoever, you know. How are you going to do it?
Who the fuck care about Mackenzie?
No, what I mean is, I want someone to say, if you want to do it, here is possibly, you know, the money. These are the resources. This is what these people are studying and why it's successful. And let's try to apply it to our own project. Because I'm sorry I'm upset, you know, but this honestly is after this, the only thing I can do is just quit my job, and I'm not going to do it.
We only have 12 minutes left, so can you make it a quick one?
I'll be as quick as I can. I mean,
I was going to say what Anna exactly said, and just something else that is related to power brokers and elites, and it's, I don't know if you know that there is a cyber war that is addressed and directed by Israel right now. And in last November, it was the fourth international conference of security and cybersecurity organized by Defense of Israel. And I'm going to give you some numbers, and you could tell me if it's this really technological sovereignty power broker or not. No? In the 2000, in Israel, there actually exists 250 enterprises about cybersecurity that they operate from Israel, and they catch $500 million only in 2015. You can talk about Trump, you can talk about Temer, you can talk about Macri, but on the very behind of all these campaigns and things, there is a big machine that is operating. I give you more details. And in the first 2 months of 2016, this Israeli cybersecurity is getting $200 million only the first 2 months of 2016, and it is calculated that they have 16,000 professionals, cybernetic professionals, already working on the cloud, doing their job. And my question, I have a lot of other details that I can give you because it's an investigation that I have been in contact in the last month. And I just want to say to you, and there is some curious things that everything that they sell outside, they have a brand that say tested in combat. This is a very interesting point because they test her unless they sell. And I think we didn't talk about this really power broker. This is really well related to technology. And as Anna said, I would like to know who is going to deconstruct this activity and who is going to start to talk and to delete this machinery that is already working on technological sovereignty.
But Hector, I don't think it's the right question for this panel.
Excuse me, but can I get in here?
Like, no, no, you will, but I just don't think they should even spend any time on it, because we asked them to talk about a certain aspect, which is mostly foundations.
Okay.
We did not ask them to talk about Israeli cybersecurity.
Okay.
So it's a fair critique to us, it's not a fair critique to them.
Okay, can I talk now? I just want to say I agree with most of what Anna's saying. The only problem is that the state is not empty. The state is a site of struggle. And I think what you said shows what a site of struggle it is. Now, when you're looking at globalizing politicians in this transnational capitalist class, they are opposed everywhere by much more locally focused politicians and bureaucrats. Everywhere in the world, especially in housing ministries. Now, if I had the time, I would talk to you about my research in Mexico, looking at the maquiladora industry and the way in which the housing ministries got involved in this debate, saying this is not a good idea, but I don't have the time. Now, Kees suggests that there's no point in struggling against the capitalist market. We are stuck with it for all eternity. That is what I take you to be saying. Now, you made fun of the degrowth. I accept you can make jokes about this, but you completely missed the point, of course, because governments today see degrowth as their biggest problem. And because they are so confused, the government policy is to get the national debt down everywhere, to get rid of debt. But on the other hand, it tells the people, buy more, borrow more. So the whole policy is completely confused. But you're right, that in the long run, if there's degrowth, it might show people what the other alternatives are. It might show them they can live without the next mobile phone, and so on and so forth. Now, on the Occupy question, and I think I was misunderstood there. The Apple rejects, whether or not they voted for Trump or not, the idea of them as an organic intellectuals is interesting. So let me pose the question to you. With the Apple rejects as an organic intellectual cadre, will they be working out how to get jobs at Apple, or will they be working out how to create the sort of society I was talking about? So my only disagreement with Anna is the disagreement about the vision for the future. As I said this morning, there's no long-term future for the state, because the socialists will be voted out of power in the next round or the round after that. The right will be back in. This is the never-ending cycle in so-called democracies, and I take Dan's point about imperfect democracies. So what the vision of the state has to be, the socialist politicians and bureaucrats, is to show people that they are not working to just create and recreate the same state processes, but they're working to build resilient communities outside the state. And they are the only people that can make this happen. So in the transition period to any sort of future society which escapes the worst excesses of the state and of the capitalist market, well, you know what my view is on that, it's essential that we work to elect socialist politicians and help socialist officials to work for the destruction of their own jobs. Now, of course, one of the things about degrowth that I
We've got to give the speakers time to wrap up, Leslie. They only have 5 minutes left in this session, and we've thrown them six rounds of comments and questions.
One last point is degrowth also addresses the issue of the working week, of cutting the hours of work. And this is very important.
We need to stop.
I'm sorry. Well, maybe you should put intervene.
We have one last intervene. Mayo, want to talk to you something? We can take this last one day.
Is this working?
Yes.
Yeah. No, I would like to bring two slogans
which were central into the rising of the citizens' candidature and the rising of 15M, and was actually two slogans that were put in place by Ada Colau. One is that we have more power than what they make us to think of. And I am thinking, and I am listening, and but it seems you are telling me, like, I thought that you are telling me that I have less power than I might think of.
No.
Like in this direction, right? And the other slogan was, yes, we can, you know? And it was the same slogan as Obama, but here it was the slogan of La Paz. So I think it's important that we reflect about the program in the event, not only on the basis of how far it should we need the translators, as Anna has said, in order to be useful. But in my sense is that how far is this empowering in how it's framed? I also want to reflect about the experience of La Paz when at the very beginning this organization between the people who has lost their houses and have to pay the mortgage and this really dramatic personal situation in which they found that was founded by Ada Colau, and the starting point was there is nothing there. We didn't need to arrive to the state to knew that there was nothing in the state. There is nothing there. There is no solidarity between us. And that was the basement of the PA in order to build solidarity between the people for stopping the eviction and helping each other to relocate the families. And this bring us about, I think solidarity should be more part of this discussion, and the power that we have and how to articulate it, and how, yes, start from nothing and start from zero because the state is empty and society is in a crisis, but still, even if there is things to do. And this has to do also when you think, you analyze the program of Podemos or you analyze the Barcelona en Comú, the key part of the electoral program was emergency, an emergency pact, how to save citizens. And this element of, even if you might achieve very few, if you only achieve that 500 less families in this city doesn't have house, it's something, you know? I want to value this. Or if we achieve that the less, I don't want to be like somehow of cursive, you know? But really, that the child stops having hunger, you know? And or when we talk about that's something, a lesson of humility that I learned when we arrived to this process of going outside of the frame of social movements and getting inside of the frame of large minority of the 99%, it was when we talk about technology, we have to start about a digital divide. That was something, it was not for me a priority. So I think this element about the importance of the urgency, the importance of the emergency, and the very minor winning, but still something there, and the starting from the very top, down of the situation, that's the starting point. And another element that has not been present into the discussion is how far the arriving to the administration and occupation of the administration has been a way of actually facilitating the growing of alternative economic activity. So basically, one lesson was arriving to the because the state is so empty, let's build our own economy. And this has been a key strategy of the Barcelona City Council in the sense of promoting the cooperatives and promoting the rebuilding of the conception of economy to a larger dimension and supporting the growth of an alternative model in the city. And if you see like the first meeting, for example, between the commons production in this city, connected to our processes, pro-commons, many people didn't know each other. They knew each other for the first time because the Barcelona City Council organized a meeting with them. So really, we have there many space for empowerment, economic empowerment too.
Okay, we're actually at the time for the session, and lunch is supposed to begin. So I'm I'm going to beg you to be strategic about what you do answer, and we can continue conversation in lunch.
Okay, thank you. That's a fantastic range of questions, and I'm not going to be able to deal with hardly any of them. But I think, to my mind, the sort of big peak point, studying elites, the big thing that comes out, apart from everything I've said, if you look at the book, I think, and elsewhere, what you find is that those people who actually hold power do not, they may believe that they are born to it and they deserve it and so on, but they are afraid. Yeah. At the center of it, they have great fear that they are going to lose control. And they define challenges to them in various ways, and they develop strategies on the basis that there are people who violently disagree with everything you stand for. So the people, and those who struggle, and those who are poor and so on, and oppressed, are not out of their picture, but they're the object of control. So they develop strategies, various strategies and so on. So, and I guess, what I'm, you should please not take anything that I've said that people shouldn't fight. People actually will fight, regardless of what anybody says, because you have to. At a certain point, you have to stand up for whatever it is which is bothering you the most at that particular time. It may be a political struggle, it may be a struggle against a particular person in your neighborhood, or against the mayor or the government or whatever. My view is you have to take that on, and you have to be able to stand up for yourself and demand your rights in that particular context. So if it means that you run for elected office in the in your locality, or you run for the monitor of whatever, the dog catcher in your neighborhood, fine, do that. Use the position. As an academic manager and an opponent of neoliberalism, I have to walk that line between enforcing neoliberal kind of norms within my colleagues and not my students, and finding them jobs in Google and so on, and saying we're creating employable graduates, as well at the same time trying to protect this idea that this is a nurturing community of educators and so on as well. We all have to make some hard decisions, and I think politicians who've got the guts to stand up and go for elected office are to be supported, because they are actually fighting that good fight, and those who are progressive, a progressive bent, I think we should support them. And so I'm not against the idea of the state. I think it can be used strategically or tactically in various ways. Struggle is there. Any form of support for that struggle, to my mind, is worthwhile. Studying elites is a good thing. I didn't start out studying elites. I started out trying to do something, to change some things or other. But what it did strike me was that these elites are studying the same thing. They're the sort of Marxists of the master class, if you like. They look to me, when I encountered Lenin before I encountered these elites. But when I looked at the way these elites organize, I thought, oh my God, this is a vanguard party. They see themselves as the vanguard, the most advanced elements who see further. You know, the kind of indispensable nation types.
Leninists with money.
Masters of the earth. That's the other thing. They have vast amounts of money from this corporate bloc. But one thing last thing I would say, which gives us hope, I think. Covering this election was really interesting in all sorts of ways, but one of them was that Sanders' average donation was $27. He outspent Hillary Clinton in advertising. She had to attend so many fundraising dinners that she couldn't actually do her campaigning. Sanders didn't do a single fundraising event. Donald Trump, he has many structural advantages. The mass media gave him $2.5 to $3 billion free advertising. He only spent about $150, $200 million of his own money in the end. But what it says is that actually if you've got, to some extent, a degree of credibility, and I think the credibility of Sanders came because he had the Democratic Party label, which still has some brand value, but he had a message which was right against that entire system. I think if you can marry those, the most important element of the two, I think you'd possibly have a chance of making some big change.
One footnote, because what Anna said was so important and everybody applauded, and I also did, because the state is always the condensation of the real balance of forces in society. So if you enter the state apparatus and public office on the basis of a movement which is really making an impact, it's something quite different from only be elected in some electoral turnaround and then finding that you have to accept all the papers that have already been signed. That is it. So it's a sort of dual power situation, but it will be grow more acute very soon. That's my opinion.
So thank our speakers, and we will now break for lunch.